is exclude. So sudden cardiac death, already told, the sudden death occurring within 1 hour, the symptom onset of the cardiac origin is the sudden cardiac death. So the causes we can broadly divide into the structural disease and ion channelopathies. This I will skip. So ventricular tachycardia is the most common arrhythmia which precedes a sudden cardiac death. Others are torsade pontis, bradycardia, and primary VF. This is very fast. So coming to the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, as previous speaker has told, it is the most common cause of sudden cardiac death in young patients, especially the athletes. It is characterized by the thickened but non-dilated left ventricle. Coming to the what is happening? This is very fast. The 12-lead ECG is abnormal in nearly 95% of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients, and the normal ECG is more common among the asymptomatic family members, which are recognized during the pedigree screening. The asymptomatic ECG is associated with a more benign clinical course. The common ECG features are increased voltage suggestive of LVH, ST segment and T wave changes, left atrial enlargement, deep and narrow Q waves. I'm helpless, this is going like anywhere. The LVH criteria on ECG includes deep S wave in lead V1 and V2 and tall R wave in lead 1 AVL, V5 and V6. There may be left axis deviation, ST segment depression and T wave inversion. The ST segment is typically either flat or slopes downward from a depressed J point, and the T wave is asymmetrically inverted. Various criteria, voltage criteria has been described for LVH. The commonly used ones are the Sokol line criteria, which says sum of S wave in V1 and R wave in V5 should be more than 3.5 millivolt and R wave in AVL should be more than 11 mm. The other is the Cornell criteria. Happening, so I'm not understanding. This is a classical ECG from a patient with asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. Here we can see the deep negative Q waves in the lead V5, V6, and the voltage criteria which meets for the LVH. It is important to note that the narrow and deep Q waves associated with the positive T wave is a marker of septal hypertrophy, type of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Coming to the apical HCM, is the relatively uncommon form of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It is seen more commonly in the Japanese patient and is characterized by the localized hypertrophy of the LV apex. The classical ECG finding of apical HCM is a giant T wave inversion in the precordial lead. This is a typical ECG of apical HCM patient. Here we see the voltage criteria which met for the LVH, and we can see the typical deep T wave inversions in all the precordial lead from V2 to the V6. Coming to the next, the arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, it is a hereditary disorder which involves mainly the right ventricle and spares the left ventricle. It is characterized by the fibrofatty replacement of the myocardium. The common ECG abnormality of ARVD are the T wave inversion in the lead V1 to V3, which is seen in nearly 85% of the patient, and the epsilon wave seen in 35% of the patient, prolonged S wave upstroke in lead V1 to V3, and the localized QRS widening more than 110 milliseconds in the right precordial leads, and the paroxysmal episodes of VT of LVB morphology, which indicate origin from the right ventricle. This is an epsilon wave, which is a prominent upright deflection after the QRS complex in the right precordial lead from the V1 to V3, and it is often associated with a negative T wave. The localized QRS widening more than 110 milliseconds in the leads V1, V2, and V3 is an important ECG sign of ARVD and is present in nearly 98% of the patient. And when we take the sum of ratio of sum of QRS duration in V1, V2, V3 divided by V2, V4, V5, and V6, it is more than 1.2 or more. This is a typical ECG of an ARVD patient. Here we see the T inversion in lead V1 to V3, the epsilon wave, and QRS duration, which is prolonged in the right precordial leads. Coming to the next group of disorders, channelopathies. This is a group of disorder which affect the cardiac ion channels and present with abnormal ECG and normal myocardial function, and can present with life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias such as syncope and sudden cardiac death. The common channelopathies are long QT, short QT, Brigada, CPVT, and malignant early repolarization. The long QT syndrome is the most common ion channelopathy and is caused by the abnormal cardiac repolarization will lead to the QT interval prolongation. The autosomal dominant form is the most common one, which was previously known as Romanowart syndrome. This patient normal hearing, and the, I will skip that. AHA defines prolonged QT as more than 450 milliseconds in the males and more than 460 milliseconds in female. As the QT interval prolongs, the risk of arrhythmia increases, and the arrhythmia is most often associated when the value is more than 500 milliseconds. It is important to measure the QT interval manually and not to rely on the computer-derived value. To measure the QT interval, you should put a perpendicular line to the starting of the Q wave, and to find the end of the T wave, we should draw a tangential line to the end of the downslope of the T wave, and the point where this meets with the isoelectric line should be taken as endpoint of the T wave. And the corrected QT interval can be get by using the Bazet's formula. There are three main types of long QT syndrome: LQT 1, 2, and 3. All these have different arrhythmogenic trigger and the characteristic T wave morphology. The sudden cardiac death occurs while swimming or during exertion or emotional stress in long QT 1, and during the postpartum period or from a sudden auditory trigger like morning alarm or sudden loud telephone ring in the long QT 2 syndrome patient. While the LQT 3 patients may die suddenly during sleep or at rest. The T wave morphology is characteristic in the long QT syndrome and help us to identify them. The T wave is typically broad based in LQT 1, and it is low amplitude, notched, or biphasic in LQT 3. In the long QT 3, there is a long isoelectric line which is followed by a narrow based T wave. This is the ECG of a typical patient with a long QT 1. Here we see the QT interval is prolonged, and we can see the broad based T wave. This is the second ECG from a LQT 2 patient. If you closely observe, we can find the bifid T wave and a long QT interval in lead 2. This is an ECG from a 5-year-old child which was obtained during a family screening of sudden cardiac death. We can notice here that long isoelectric segment followed by a narrow base T wave. The macroscopic T wave alternance is a characteristic sign of long QT syndrome and is characterized by beat-to-beat variation in the T wave polarity and amplitude. It may occur briefly at rest, and it's usually associated during emotional stress or physical exertion and may precede the torsade pontes. In this long lead 2, we see the alternative positive and negative T waves. This is another example of a T wave alternance from a 3-year-old child with having multiple episodes of cardiac arrest. We can see alternate positive and negative T waves here. The risk factors are already told before. The torsade pontes is the term specifically reserved for the polymorphic VT occurring in a setting of the QT interval prolongation. The irregular rhythm with long and short RR intervals are frequent sign of frequent trigger of torsade pontes. This is the ECG where we can see the short run of polymorphic VT, and we can see in the preceding there is a sinus bradycardia, there is a ventricular biogemini, and prolonged QT interval. The Schwartz criteria has been already discussed previously. In the presence of the wide QRS complex such as RVB, LVB, WPW, non-specific IVCD, the measurement of the ventricular repolarization by QTC alone will be incorrect and will be subject to measurement errors. In this patient, we should take a JTC interval. The JTC interval is taken from the starting point of the J point to the end of the T wave, and the normal JT interval is 320 to 400 milliseconds. The prolonged QT dispersion, more than 65 milliseconds, is a high risk for ventricular arrhythmia and is a risk marker for sudden cardiac death. As the long QT leads to the sudden cardiac death, so is the short QT syndrome. The Schottky syndrome is an autosomal dominant variant which is caused by gain of function mutation of the potassium channel. It is a highly malignant disorder which can present with sudden cardiac death from infancy to the childhood, infancy to the younger adults. It is defined by on ECG as a short QTC interval which is less than 330 milliseconds. And when the QTC is between 330 to 360 milliseconds, we need additional criteria to say it is a short QTC syndrome, which includes identification of the pathogenic mutation, family history of sudden short QTC syndrome, family history of sudden cardiac death, and survival of a VT or VF episode in the absence of the heart disease. The ECG is very interesting in short QTC syndrome. The QT interval is short, the ST segment may be short or absent, and the T wave starts immediately from the S wave. The T wave is tall, narrow, and symmetrical, and the patients may have atrial fibrillation, VT, and VF. This is an ECG from a 16-year-old child who presents with a history of syncope. We can see the short QT syndrome and the tall and narrow symmetrical T waves here. Short's criteria has also been described for diagnosis of the short QT syndrome. Coming to the Brugada syndrome, this is the second most common ion channelopathy. It is a dominant disorder and it's more common in male patients. It presents with a sudden death at rest from ventricular fibrillation in young men. Brugada syndrome is characterized by the downsloping ST segment elevation in the right precordial leads. The ECG changes may be present at rest or may appear intermittently. And the risk of sudden cardiac death is higher in those patients who have symptoms or who have abnormal ECG at the baseline. There are three main types of Brugada syndrome, type 1, 2, and 3. Type 1 is characterized by the code ST segment elevation in the right precordial leads followed by inverted T waves. And type 2 and type 3 has a saddleback type of ST segment elevation. This is an ECG from a type 1 Brugada syndrome. We can find the code ST segment elevation in lead V1, V2, and V3. In symptomatic patients, the QRS duration is more. It is averages around 130 milliseconds. Compared to the asymptomatic patient, where the average was around 108 milliseconds, and it is a marker for a life-threatening ventricular arrhythmia in Brugada syndrome patient. This is how to take a QRS duration in a Brugada syndrome. From the starting of the Q wave to the J point, we have to take. As the resting ECG may be normal, the sensitivity of the resting ECG may be increased by higher placement of the lead V1 and V2 into the second intercostal space. And the Brugada pattern can be unmasked by using the drugs like H-melin, flecainide, and procainamide.